Good evening. Welcome back to Smyrna Christian Church. Back in Acts chapter 13. I'm going to pick it up in verse 34 tonight. Remember, we have Paul doing this Bible study, quite similar to the one that Stephen gave us in a previous chapter. And Paul told us in our last study how, after the first man king of Israel, which would be Saul, after that, God's going to raise up a man after his own heart, which would be David. And remember, all the kings after David would be compared to him. David wasn't perfect. He made some pretty big mistakes, but one thing David never did is fall away into idolatry. He never worshipped any god except the true God, Yahweh. Paul would go on to tell us about John the Baptist, how John the Baptist would preach, be saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Remember, John the Baptist was that voice crying from the wilderness, quoted in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3, that forerunner to the coming of Jesus Christ, the last prophet. And today, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is nigh. We always want to repent of our sins, because if you don't repent, all your sins are just stacked up right next to your name in the book of life. But all you have to do is repent, ask for forgiveness sincerely, and your sins are washed away as if they never even existed. And Paul talked about how the crucifixion of Jesus Christ was prophesied long ago by the prophets. Psalms 22 gave us detail by detail of the crucifixion 1,000 years before it ever happened. You have Isaiah 53 as well, and many places it's prophesied of. But those two places, Psalms 22, Isaiah 53, you get just detail by detail of the crucifixion. And Paul's quoted so much Old Testament, he's going to keep doing it. We went to two different places in Psalms in our last study, Psalms chapter 2 and Psalms chapter 89, where God let us know, He reassured us that Almighty God is our defense. Jesus Christ is our defense. God even said in that Psalms 89, He said, "I will beat down your foes before your face. You don't have to worry about them." And said, I mean, why do the heathen rage? Because they don't care about God. They don't love God. All they care about is just hurting those who do right. But God let us know, don't worry. I'm your defense. I'm your shield. I'm your buckler. And I think the very last verse that we read in our study was, blessed are those who trust in the Lord, who trust in Yahweh. Don't have anything to worry about if you have God on your side. Things might get a little rough, but God will always bring you through it, just as He tells us in 1 Corinthians 10:13. So we're going to pick it up, chapter 13, verse 34. Let's ask a word of wisdom from our Father.
Yahweh, Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your written word and for giving us a building we can come and teach Your word. And we just ask You to guide us through this study with Your Holy Spirit. We ask You to give us eyes to see and ears to hear, to understand and teach Your word. We ask that Your words be spoken and Your will be done during this study. Thank You, Father. Yeshua, Jesus' precious name. Amen.
All right, book of Acts, chapter 13, verse 34,
and it reads, "And it's concerning that He raised Him up from the dead, now no more to return to corruption. He said on this wise, I will give you the sure mercies of David."
That word mercies is an interesting word. It's almost every other place it's translated as holy. God's saying, I will give you the holy things. Meaning His wisdom, His love, His forgiveness that He so loves to give if you just love Him. Do you remember what it says in Hosea chapter 6, verse 6? How God said, I don't desire burnt offerings. I don't desire your sacrifices. But He said, I want you to love Me. And He said, I want you to have knowledge of Me. So that's what God wants, your love. And for you to study His Word so you do have knowledge of Him.
And what that means, He will no more return to corruption.
Of course, the Lord Jesus Christ was crucified. 3 days later, He resurrected. It's saying that His flesh body did not decay. He was transfigured. That way, no one could try to say, oh no, He didn't really resurrect. There's His dead body right there. No, His flesh body did not see corruption. But He was resurrected. He walked for 40 days after that. And then He returned to the Father to sit on the right hand of God. But do you know what this is quoting? This is quoting Isaiah chapter 55. Once again, Paul quoted in the Old Testament. I want to go there and read a few verses. In this chapter that we've been reading, Acts 13, the Old Testament's probably been quoted at least 10 times or more. So don't let anyone ever try to tell you that you don't need to read the Old Testament. That would be one of the biggest lies you could ever be told. Paul being a great scholar of the Old Testament. So Isaiah chapter 55, let's pick it up, verse 1. And it reads, "Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money," saying you don't need any money. What is the water? It's the living water, the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember in the book of John, he would come to the well with the woman coming there, and he let her know that if you just drink normal water, you're going to thirst again. But if you partake of the living water, the salvation of the Lord Jesus Christ, then you will never thirst again. "Come ye, buy and eat. Yea, come, buy wine and milk, without money and without price." See, we don't have to pay any price for salvation, but it sure wasn't free. Jesus Christ paid an enormous price. God came in the flesh as the Son, suffered, was mocked, taunted, beaten, and He was crucified. He was murdered. But like we said, 3 days later, He resurrected so He would defeat the devil, which is what it says in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. So that all we have to do is repent, and we can have that eternal life. Remember that water, that's the living water, and the bread, once again, the bread of life, which is Jesus Christ. You don't need any money for that. Christ paid the price on the cross. Verse 2. And of course, the wine being symbolic of the blood that Christ even shed. Verse 2. Wherefore, why do you spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness. Now understand what this is talking about. So let your soul delight. This is not saying, oh, well, why are you working so you can eat? No, this is talking about in the religious sense. What does it say in 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 8? It says, if a man won't work and take care of himself, and if he won't even take care of his family, which would be even worse, it says he's denied the faith and is worse than an infidel. He's worse than a non-believer if he claims to be Christian, but he won't even work to take care of his own family. So don't ever let someone twist this on you. This is talking about the way that we worship God. What it's saying is, why are you doing all this stuff that you call religious, but it's not doing you any good? Traditions of men, I mean, if you think traditions of men is something you want to follow, read Colossians chapter 2 about the last 5 verses. Let you know it's absolutely meaningless. And that's what this is talking about. Why are you doing all these things? That's just going to come out to nothing. It's not going to satisfy your soul, even though it seems to be so holy, so religious. Don't go after the traditions of men. Go after the Word of God that the Lord gave us exactly as it is written. Verse 3. Incline your ear and come unto me. Hear, and your soul shall live. Check out this word "hear" in the Hebrew. It means to hear intelligently with obedience. What does it say in the book of James? It says that don't just be a hearer, but be a doer. It is not enough just to hear God's word. You have to hear it intelligently with understanding and be obedient to it. And it says if you do that, your soul shall live. Once again, this is talking about your soul, your eternal life. And I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David. This is what we just quoted in the book of Acts. Verse 4. Behold, I have given him for a witness to the people, a leader and commander to the people. Who's this talking about? This is talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. 5. Behold, thou shalt call a nation that thou knowest not, and nations that knew not thee shall run unto thee because of the Lord thy God, and for the Holy One of Israel, for he hath glorified thee. And that's what we've been learning about these last few chapters of Acts. Salvation is for whomsoever will. And you know, that's what the millennium's all about. Even someone, if they had never even heard of Jesus Christ in their flesh body, you'd have a lot of people falsely tell you, oh, they're hell bound. They didn't accept Jesus Christ in the flesh. That's not what God's Word says at all. When the true Jesus Christ returns at the 7th trumpet, the millennium, the 1,000-year teaching period of Revelation chapter 20 begins. And all those who never had the chance to learn the truth, they get that opportunity in that millennium. No one is cast into the lake of fire until the end of that time, the end of the millennium. And only the people who follow Satan at the end of that will be cast into the lake of fire and blotted out. Only the absolute most wicked of the wicked will be cast into the lake of fire. So don't let anyone try to twist you up on that. Go one more verse here, a couple verses. Verse 6. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. call ye upon him while he is near, and he is near to us. Like another place it would say in Isaiah, you don't have to go to the ends of the earth, you don't have to go up to heaven or down to the bottom of the sea to get the truth. God gave us it right here in this Word of God. It's right here for the taking. Don't be like the member in Matthew 25, you have 10 virgins, but 5 of them, they didn't have any oil in their lamp. I mean, they didn't study God's Word. They didn't have the truth. Then they heard that the wedding had come. They heard the Messiah had returned. So they went out to worship him. Only one problem. It's the false Christ that comes first. So then those 5 virgins who had no truth, they were no longer spiritual virgins because they worshiped the false Messiah. Do not let that happen. Verse 7. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. It's saying, even get the bad thoughts out of your head. All you got to do is ask God. He'll do it for you. You just got to put forth the effort. And let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Once again, let's go back to the book of Acts. Once again, all you got to do is ask for that forgiveness. And he abundantly pardons. That means he erases your sin. All you have to do is ask him sincerely for forgiveness. Let's go back to the book of Acts. Keep going in this Acts chapter 13. Acts chapter 13, verse 35. And it reads, wherefore he saith also in another psalm, thou shalt not suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. This is Psalm chapter 16, verse 10. We're not going to go there, but it is an awesome psalm. It'd be do you well to read it. It's only, I think, 11 verses. But once again, Christ's body, his flesh body, did not decay. It did not see corruption. Verse 7. For David, after he had served his own generation by the will of God, which is all of our jobs to do, fell on sleep. His flesh body died and was laid unto his fathers and saw corruption. His flesh body decayed, of course. But what does it say in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verses 6 and 7? When your flesh body dies, your soul returns to the Father. You don't need your flesh anymore. It means nothing. It goes back to the earth from which it came. But your spirit, your soul returns to the Father from whence it came. And you go to either the good side of the gulf or the bad side. I quote is Luke chapter 16, verse 37. But he whom God raised again saw no corruption. Once again, that's the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 38. Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins. Once again, the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you remember what it says in 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 through 10? It says, if anybody says that they do not sin, then they deceive themselves and they call God a liar. We all sin. You got a lot of people who are so holier than thou. They probably think they don't sin. But you understand, if you try to say you don't sin, you call God a liar, and you're deceiving your own self. But then what does it say in verse 9, the first epistle of John chapter 1? It says that God is righteous, and all we have to do is ask for forgiveness, and he cleanses us of all unrighteousness. But you got to ask him. Some people would falsely teach, you don't even have to repent of your sins. What a lie. Luke chapter 13, verse 3 says, repent, because if you don't, you will perish. Speaking of your soul, ultimately. But just ask for forgiveness, and it is erased as if it never existed. Even Isaiah chapter 43, verse 25, God says, I will remember your sin no more. That's how much it's blotted out. It's erased. It's like it never happened when you truly repent. Verse 39. And by him, by Jesus Christ, all that believe are justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. You know what that word justified means? It means regarded as innocent. Nobody could be justified by the law because we all sin. The law is not done away with. We talked about that many times. Just a chapter or two ago, this is 10 years after Christ's resurrection, Paul and Barnabas are in the synagogue teaching the law and teaching the prophets. So don't let anyone try to tell you the law is done away with. Matthew chapter 5, verse 17 and 18 will document that also. But it was impossible for us to be justified by the law. We had to have the Savior. And Christ did come and pay that price so we could have that forgiveness. For all we have to do is repent. And we are back in good standing with Almighty God. Verse 40. Beware, therefore, lest that come upon you which is spoken of in the prophets. Verse 41. Behold, ye despisers and wonder and perish. This word perish means to vanish away. It's saying that's what's going to happen to the wicked. For I work a work in your days, a work which ye shall in no wise believe, though a man declare it unto you. You know what this is quoting? It's quoting Habakkuk chapter 1. Well, what's this work that he's saying he's going to work that you will not believe? Well, it tells you in Habakkuk chapter 1, what's the very next verse say, verse 6? It speaks of the coming of the Chaldeans. Remember, Habakkuk was during the same time of Jeremiah. Habakkuk and Jeremiah both prophesied, look, the king of Babylon is coming. And that was the history. But what's that in prophecy? The false Christ is coming. Satan is going to be cast out onto this earth claiming to be God. And remember, he performs miracles and he brings world peace. He deceives the whole world except for God's elect. All those three things I just said, you can read in Revelation chapter 13. So that time is coming. What's it say? It says, beware lest that come upon you. Lest you didn't take the time to study, you don't even know that's going to happen, and you would fall away to worship the first supernatural entity that claims to be God. Don't let that happen. So that's Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 5 being quoted. And there's another place, and I want to go read it because just a few verses. I want to go to Isaiah chapter 41, how it talks about that the enemy is going to perish, meaning they're going to vanish away. And it just goes too perfect with this verse not to read. We're just going to read, I think, four verses. Isaiah chapter 41, we're going to pick it up, verse 10. Isaiah 41, verse 10, and it reads, fear thou not, for I am with thee. This is Almighty God speaking. You don't have anything to fear if you truly serve Him. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. Now, you can get so much more out of this if you check this out in the Hebrew. That word strengthen, it means that God will make you alert and He will give you courage. For you don't ever have to fear the enemy. And remember Isaiah 43:26, where God says, remind me of my promises so I can justify you? This is a promise. God saying, I will strengthen you. I will make you alert. I will give you courage. That word help, it means to surround and protect. God surrounds you with that heavenly host of angels if you truly love Him. Make a note of Matthew chapter 18, verse 10, where it says, you better be real careful if you despise one of God's little ones. Because their angel beholds the face of God at any time. You claim these promises that God gave to you. And that word uphold, it means that He will sustain, and it means that He will even follow you closely. God is always watching. He knows if someone's coming against you, and you don't have to fear because God is with you. Verse 11. Behold, all they that were incensed against thee shall be ashamed and confounded. They shall be as nothing. And they that strive with thee shall perish. Don't worry, God's going to get rid of them. Check out this word, incensed. That means that they have zeal or anger against you. Then all those that they're all puffed up, trying to intimidate you, trying to bring about people to come against you. God's saying, don't worry. They're going to be ashamed, confounded. They're going to be as nothing. Those that strive with you shall perish. Verse 12. Thou shalt seek them, and thou shalt not find them. Even them that contended with thee. They that war against thee shall be as nothing, and as a thing of naught. You understand what God's saying? He's saying, those that came against you, that it's gonna be a little while, but you can handle it, but it's not gonna be too long. That even if you tried to look for your enemies, you couldn't even find them. That's how much God destroys those that come against you. Verse 12. We got that. One more verse here, verse 13. For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, fear not, I will help thee. Once again, that means He will surround you, He will protect you. Two times in four verses said, fear not, for I am with you. So don't ever fear the enemy if you love Almighty God and you truly do your best to serve Him. Let's go back, keep going to Acts 13. Acts chapter 13, picking it back up. In verse 42, Acts chapter 13, verse 42, and it reads, and when the Jews were gone out of the synagogue, the Gentiles besought that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. Now check out this word next. What this means is in between. What they're saying is that they don't want to wait until the next Sabbath. They don't want to be taught the word in that time that's in between the two Sabbaths. That's how they excited they were that they heard the truth. They couldn't wait another 7 days. No, they were starving for that truth and they wanted to keep hearing it. Because it wasn't the words of men, but it was the word of God.
Verse 43.
Now when the congregation was broken up, when they were released, many of the Jews and religious proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas, who, speaking to them, persuaded them to continue in the grace of God. Paul and Barnabas urged the people to just do your very best to please God. We're all going to fall short at times. Our righteous acts are as filthy rags compared to Jesus Christ, is what it would say in another place in Isaiah. But they wanted to hear the truth. And Paul and Barnabas saying, just do your best. Do your very best. Don't just say you're doing your best, but truly try your best to serve God. And that word grace, it even means the favor that God gives that we don't even deserve. And it can also mean divine influence on the heart. And that's what God will give you. If you seek out the truth, if you seek, then you will find. Verse 44. And that word proselytes, if you don't know, it means that they were converted. So let's go another verse. Verse 44. And the next Sabbath day, so this is translated properly. We're coming to the next Sabbath day, 7 days later from the other Sabbath. The next Sabbath day came almost the whole city together to hear the word of God. Did it say they came to hear the words of Paul and Barnabas? They came to hear the words of the traditions of men? No, they came to hear the word of God. That's what changes lives. That's what brings about salvation when you come to the truth. And you don't just go to some church just to play religion for an hour. Just to be a holy roller. But you come to hear the word of God, and it will change your life forever. You will have wisdom, you'll have truth, you'll have the courage that God says He'll give you. That's what the word of God does that man could never do.
Verse 45. But when the Jews saw the multitudes, remember this word Jews in the Greek is Iudas.
It can mean someone that is of the tribe of Judah, or just an Israelite, or it can mean someone who just lives in Judea. That's what this is talking about, those who live in Judea.
They saw the multitudes, they were filled with envy and spake against those things which were spoken by Paul, contradicting and blaspheming.
You got the Kenites mixed in among these people. They didn't want people to hear the truth. Not only that, but people were coming out of their synagogues. They wanted to hear Paul and Barnabas, but they didn't want to hear Paul and Barnabas. They wanted to hear the word of God. But pulling away from these other people who just did a lot of religion, did a whole lot of holy stuff, but they didn't teach the word exactly as it's written in depth. But check out that word blasphemy. They probably were blaspheming Jesus Christ, but what does this really mean? It means to slander. They were slandering Paul and Barnabas, just making up lies, doing everything that they could to turn people away from Paul and Barnabas. But a true student of God's word, they don't follow any man. They only follow the word, and that's all that matters.
Verse 46.
And also remember 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 23, the example that Jesus Christ set before us. It says, when they reviled him, he didn't revile back. He didn't mock back at them. It says, when he suffered, he threatened not, but he put himself in the hands of him that judges righteously, which is Almighty God. That's what we must always do. People are going to hate you and come against you when you teach the truth with no apology. Don't worry. Fear not, for God is with you.
Verse 46.
Then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said, it was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you. But seeing ye put it from you, and judge yourself unworthy of everlasting life, we turn to the Gentiles.
And you can kind of read this in Romans chapter 11, verses 11 through 14. And it will tell you in that chapter how many people are blinded, but the elect have obtained it.
But it says, through the fall of the Israelites, salvation has come on the Gentiles. And you know what it even says? It says that the coming of the Gentiles into the truth of Jesus Christ, it was even to really make the Israelites a little jealous. Because it was sent to the Israelites first. But then they went away from God. But then they see all these other nations, all these other people coming to God. That's going to make them jealous. And that's going to turn them, hopefully, back to the Father. Remember, God's plan is always so perfect. He understands how we are. Why? Because He created a very soul. and no ever overlooked that. They waxed bold. That means that they were very frank and they were very blunt with what they said. They didn't apologize for it. And they were very confident in their spirit and their demeanor. Didn't matter that a whole bunch of people were mocking them and making up lies about them. And you always remember that because you are to be an example to the people. Yeah, even though things might get real rough, always have a smile on your face, because when it's too hard for everybody else, that's just perfect for you. You're a servant of the living God. You're God's elect. Always come with a smile because you know God protects you. And people will see that. They'll see horrible things happening to you. And they'll be like, how is he handling this so well? Well, of course, because of Almighty God. So you use this example that Paul and Barnabas and the Lord Jesus Christ gave us. Never let your spirit or your demeanor get low and depressed. God lifts you up always. Remember 2 Corinthians 12:9-10. When we're at our weakest, Jesus Christ makes us our strongest. Verse 47. For so hath the Lord commanded us, saying, I have set thee to be a light of the Gentiles, that thou shouldest be for salvation unto the ends of the earth. Remember, this is for whomsoever will. All people, all races, anyone who loves the Lord Jesus Christ, even a Kenite, if they truly love the Lord Jesus Christ, they have eternal life abiding in them. Now, what's this quoting? This is quoting another place in Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 49. I want to go there and read just a few verses as well, so we can see that it was always God's plan that all people come to salvation. It wasn't only just after the crucifixion God decided He wanted all people to have eternal life. No, God always wanted that people to have eternal life. And it's written so clearly here in Isaiah, book of Isaiah, chapter 45. Going to pick it up in verse 5. Isaiah chapter 45, verse 5. And it reads, I am the Lord, there is none else. There is no God beside me. I girded thee, though thou hast not known me. Verse 6. That they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is none beside me. I am the Lord, and there is none else. I meant to go to Isaiah 49, didn't I? I'm in Isaiah chapter 45. Those were two good verses we just read, but I meant for Isaiah chapter 49. So here we go, Isaiah chapter 49, verse 5, and it reads, And now saith the Lord that formed me from the womb, to be His servant, to bring Jacob again to Him. Though Israel be not gathered, yet shall I be glorious in the eyes of the Lord, and my God shall be my strength. You know who this is talking about? This is talking about, once again, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Verse 6, And He said, It is a light thing that thou shouldest be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved of Israel. I will also give thee for a light to the Gentiles, that thou mayest be my salvation unto the ends of the earth. Yeshua, which is even Jesus Christ's name, means Yahweh Savior. It was God's plan long ago to raise up the Savior so all people could have eternal life if they love Jesus Christ. That's the requirement. No one comes to the Father except through the Son. Verse 7. Thus saith the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel and His Holy One, to Him whom man despiseth. A lot of people, they do despise Jesus Christ. They don't think it's really important to follow Him. Well, boy, are they in for a rude awakening. To Him whom the nation abhorreth, to a servant of rulers, kings shall see and arise. Princes also shall worship because of the Lord that is faithful and the Holy One of Israel. And He shall choose thee. You know what that means, that He's faithful? That means that not only does it mean you can always trust Him, but it also means that He will build you up and He will support you. Verse 8, Thus saith the Lord, In an acceptable time have I heard thee, and in a day of salvation have I helped thee. And I will preserve thee, that means He will guard, He will protect you, and give thee for a covenant of the people, to establish the earth, to cause to inherit the desolate heritages. Verse 9. That thou mayest say to the prisoners, Go forth. And them that are in darkness, show yourselves. Come out of darkness. Come out of the shackles of this world. Jesus Christ will release you from all of it if you just ask Him. Show yourselves that they shall feed in the ways, and their pastures shall be in all high places. One more verse here. Verse 10. They shall not hunger nor thirst. Why? Because they come after the living water, the bread of life, which is Jesus Christ. You will never thirst again. Neither shall the heat nor sun smite them. For he that hath mercy on them shall lead them. Even by the springs of water shall he guide them. Once again, that word guide means to protect. This is even quoted in Revelation chapter 7, verses 16 and 17. And remember, let's go back and let's finish this Acts chapter 13. You remember what it says also in in Revelation chapter 7, verse 17? It says God wipes all tears away. He will even do it now if you trust Him. But it even looks forward to even the third earth age, the eternal heaven, where there will be no more tears. There will just be perfection. Because Satan and all those who followed Him are blotted out. They've been gone into smoke forever and no longer exist. That's what the place that we strive to get to. Let's finish up this Acts chapter 13 to complete. Acts chapter 13, verse 48. Acts 13, 48, and it reads, "And when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and glorified the word of the Lord." Once again, they weren't glorifying Paul and Barnabas, but the word of God. "And as many as were ordained to eternal life believed." And remember John chapter 1, verse 1. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." In verse 14, "The Word became flesh and dwelt among us." That's what they glorified, the Word which is the Son of Jesus Christ. Verse 49. "And the Word of the Lord was published throughout all the region." I mean, that truth was spreading, because it was truth. 50. But the Jews stirred up the devout and honorable women and the chief men of the city and raised persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them out of their coast." Once again, always going to happen. People are going to try to bring persecution against you if you teach the truth. It's always going to happen. It always has happened. It always will happen. But God will bring you through it every single time. Once again, the Jews, the ones who lived in Judea, you got the Kenites mixed in among here. And that word stirred up, it means they incited hostility. Just doing whatever they could, just bringing people to go against Paul and Barnabas. The devout, that means the people who were religious. The word honorable means elegant. They stirred up all these people that claimed to be so religious and so elegant. The holier than thou. They thought they were so holy they didn't even want to go around sinners. And it's real easy to incite them into hostility because they already think they're better than everybody else. So yeah, it's not hard for them to stir up and come against a true servant of God's Word. But be happy, because it says in Luke chapter 6, verse 22, "Blessed are you when men shall hate you and cast out your name as evil for Christ's sake, for great is your reward in heaven." And Paul and Barnabas, no doubt, have incredible rewards in heaven at this very moment. Verse 51, "But they shook off the dust of their feet against them and came unto Iconium. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit." Do you understand that even though many, many people were coming against them, they were still filled with joy? They still rejoiced? Remember a few chapters ago, Acts chapter 5, about the last 10 verses? Gamaliel let the people know, look, you better be real careful that these people, they wouldn't be able to do these things if they weren't true servants of God. And Gamaliel told him, he said, look, you keep going against them, you're probably going to be fighting against God Himself. And that's not something you want to do. And it said there that a true servants of God, a true ministry that teaches God's Word, it cannot be overthrown if it's truly of God. So don't ever forget that. Remember, you are a teacher. You plant the seeds. You study the truth, so when you feel led by the Holy Spirit, you can share the truth. People are going to come against you. Let it happen. It doesn't matter. And that little phrase I always said, they shook off the dust from their feet. That quote, that's even take you back to Matthew chapter 10, where Jesus Christ sending out the disciples, telling them what to do, saying, don't take a begging bag. You have the ability through the name of Christ to cast out evil spirits, cleanse the sick. But what did Christ say? He said, you inquire and find out who is worthy. That doesn't mean you judge. That means you use spiritual discernment so you can tell if someone truly wants to hear the truth or if they just want to play games or if they just want to argue. So you use spiritual discernment. You go to people who do want to hear the truth. But if they don't, shake the dust off your feet. Don't cast your pearls before swine, like it says in Matthew chapter 7, verse 6. And you shake the dust off your feet. And you know what it says there? It says that on Judgment Day, it would be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah than it would be those who refused and went against the true servant of God. So don't ever forget that. And Paul, like I said, at least probably 10 times he quoted the Old Testament in Acts chapter 13. Over and over and over telling us, you don't have anything to fear. God's going to destroy your enemies. That was such an awesome verse in Isaiah. He said, after a little while, even if you went looking for your enemies, you wouldn't even be able to find them. God banishes them away. You never have anything to worry about ever if you truly serve God with all your heart and soul. Praise God for that. Let's go to His throne.
Yahweh, Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your protection and Your wisdom from Your Word and the love You give us, and for your forgiveness, for coming in the flesh as the Son and dying on the cross and resurrecting so we could have eternal life if we repent. And we just thank You for giving us this building we have so we can come and teach Your Word exactly as it's written. And we just ask You to continue to guide us with Your Holy Spirit to give us understanding, not just for ourselves, but so we can share it with others. Thank You, and we love You, Father. In Yeshua, Jesus' precious name.
This is recorded July the 15th, 2020 at Smyrna Christian Church, 1623 North Burnham, Kokomo, Indiana. Come join Pastor Jesse Sisk on Wednesday, Thursdays, and Fridays at 7 p.m. and Sunday mornings at 10 a.m. God bless.